Thank you all for joining us this evening for our webinar, COVID-19 Care, Practice Security and Staff Safety, Protecting Patients and Staff from COVID-19 Stress-Induced Violence. Our speaker today is going to be Stephen S. Wilder, and he's with the company of Sorensen Wilder and Associates, which is a nationally recognized leader in safety and security, emergency preparedness, disaster management, and public safety consulting. Steve himself has spent the past 32 years in healthcare safety, security, and risk management. And I'll let him tell you a little bit more about himself as we move on. And he can explain to you what that alphabet are, those credentials after his name are. Next slide, and we'll go over a little bit of the housekeeping. Wanted to let you know you are all muted. You will stay muted, but we do want you to ask questions. So please feel free to type them into the question box, and we will answer them at the end of the presentation. If you have some sort of technical difficulty, or if you have a general comment, feel free to just type it into the chat box and we'll try to address anything that we can for you. The slides and the recording of the presentation will be available on the AOA website within probably 2 to 3 days. So by the end of the week, they will be there. And then one reminder, to obtain your CME credit, what you need to do following the presentation is go back onto the AOA online learning platform. And you go into the course, and within the course, you'll find the post-webinar evaluation. You need to take that, and then once you've taken that and passed it, you will be awarded your CME credit. The disclaimer basically is just to tell you that this material is strictly for educational purposes and it's not to be considered a legal or consulting opinion. So keep that in mind, and that the information is current as it was developed. And now the next slide, and I will turn it over to Steve. Steve?
Thanks, Cindy. Good evening, everybody, and thanks for allowing me to spend a little bit of your evening with you. As Cindy said, my name's Steve Wilder. I'm President and Chief Operating Officer of a company by the name of Sorensen Wilder & Associates. We are based in Bradley, Illinois, which I know a lot of you are local, so that is familiar territory. For those of you that are not, we are snuggled, we're about 60 miles south of Chicago. Commercial community snuggled between Bourbonnais and Kankakee. My background, I spent the first 15 years of my career, dating back to the early 1980s, as the director of risk management at a hospital here in Kankakee. At that time, Kankakee was a much more violent community than it is now. It was in the top 10 in the United States per capita for violent crime. And ours was the only trauma center at the time. And we were the local knife and gun club, if you will. So had an opportunity to become involved, like it or not, in a lot of incidents of healthcare workplace violence and dealing with a lot of de-escalation and aggression management. After 15 years at the hospital, as hospitals became part of larger healthcare systems, ours was no different. I had the opportunity given to me to go to the corporate office, where I spent 5 years as the corporate director of risk management for the long-term care division, which was my first venture into long-term care and was a great learning opportunity. In 2001, we had a new CEO that came in at the corporate office, felt we were a little too top-heavy, and I was one of 29 corporate executives downsized out of the organization. Thought it was the worst day of my life, turned out to be the best day of my life, because as part of my separation package, they knew that my business partner, a gentleman by the name of Chris Sorensen, and I had been working and developing a small consulting practice. And part of what they did is they set us up with a management consulting group out of Oak Brook, Illinois, that worked with small business startups. And they helped us get going. And here we are today with about 18 full-time employees and over 500 clients in 49 states. So people say you've been pretty lucky. I say, no, we've been pretty blessed. Hard work and a lot of other things paid off. I have the privilege today of working with a lot of great healthcare associations and groups in both the hospital and in the long-term care division. Frequent writer. I also have the privilege of serving dual careers for much of my adult life. I spent 35 years in the fire service. I spent 31 years with the fire department in Bradley, Illinois. I spent the last 8 as the fire chief there and retired. I also had the privilege of teaching for 25 years as adjunct faculty at the State Fire Academy at the University of Illinois. And I also spent several years as adjunct faculty at Southern Illinois University in Carbondale, teaching in the healthcare risk management program. So I share that with you only because I think it's important that as we're talking about this, that you appreciate my background is not only healthcare, but is also in emergency management, public safety, which does provide a lot of valuable resources to me when we're talking about emergency operations planning. You know, a year ago, if you'd have told me that, number one, we would be doing our programs via Zoom or go to webinar, any of those forums, I'd have told you were nuts. But if you'd have told me that our nation would be in some form of a shutdown, I'd have thought you were a little bit on the crazy side as well. But COVID-19 has given us a lot of new challenges that we face now. Please appreciate I'm a non-critical risk manager. And my focus is usually entirely on safety, regulatory safety, OSHA compliance, those types of things, and security, whether it's hospital security, long-term care, practice management. You know, 15 years at the hospital, we had a lot of hospital and practices, so I was very intimately involved with the security management program for those hospitals, or hospital-based practices, I should say. And I've had the privilege of working with practice management groups across the country now for almost 20 years. So a lot of challenges we're facing. First one, the COVID-19 is starting to really throw in our face is the risk of workplace violence. And we're going to talk about these in a few minutes, so I'm not going to go into too much detail right now, but we're starting to see good people being pushed to the breaking point. And they're starting to manage their stress in ways that a year ago, they nor we would have ever imagined they were dealing with it. We're seeing a big spike in domestic violence, quarantining, family isolation, those type of things. We're seeing a tremendous spike here in my community. The small village of Bourbonnais saw an 800% increase in domestic violence calls since the quarantine and the isolation started. You know, families, as much as they love each other, are spending so much time together now with no opportunity to escape that their stress levels are out of this world. We're seeing threats against staff members. And we're going to talk about these all. We're dealing with disgruntled workers. A lot of our workforce has been pushed to the max. And because of that, you know, we're asking our workers more than we ever have in the past to do more with less. And a lot of them are at the breaking point. They're giving everything they have to give, but they're feeling the effects of it. They're feeling it in the workplace, they're feeling it on the home front, and they're feeling it in their personal life and their own physical health. And we're starting to see threats of active shooters. And this is one that really scares me because when somebody threatens an active shooter, and we're going to talk about this in the program tonight, when somebody talks about an active shooter or threatens some type of a shooting event, we have to take it as a capable and as a meaningful threat. Friends, the first thing we got to do is get our heads out of the sand. We have to get past this prevailing attitude that says it won't happen here. I defy any of you to give me a reason why it can't happen in your practice. And gosh, guys, I've heard every excuse under the sun. Oh, see, if we know our patients, we work with them, they rely on us, we're close with their families, we go to graduations, we go to weddings, blah, blah, blah. I don't care. I don't mean to sound disrespectful. I'm just being candid with you. When a person is pushed to the breaking point, they are capable of anything. So the first thing you've got to do, whether you want to do it or not, you've got to accept the fact that any of the things that we're going to talk about tonight in our time together can happen in your facility, can happen in your practice, can happen in your office. Now, we talk first about workplace violence. And, you know, I use a real generic definition, but this is almost identical to the one that OSHA uses. Workplace violence, in its simplest terms, is any incident in which an employer or an employee is threatened, intimidated, verbally attacked, physically attacked, harassed, injured, or killed. Now let's take a look very quickly at that definition. Think about your day-to-day practice. How many of you have had patients or family members of patients who have come in and threatened you or some of your staff? Who have attempted to intimidate you or some of your staff? Who have verbally attacked you or some of your staff? And when I say verbally attacked, that can be a simple cussing out, if you will, a profanity-laden tirade that they go on. Flipping you the finger, something as simple as a hand gesture in a physician's office, can constitute a verbal attack. When we talk about physically attacked, where they turn to physical violence against you, harassment, and certainly anybody who's ever been injured, or God forbid any of you have had an employee killed because of this, but as you'll see in a few minutes, it has happened, and in some cases, relatively locally. These are the types of events that OSHA is looking at. These are the types of events, and yes, in your private practice, OSHA does have authorization, authority, if you will, and they can come in. All it takes is an upset employee to call the OSHA 800 hotline and say, I'm getting tired of being harassed at work. I'm getting tired of having family members of patients threatening me because they can't come back in or they can't be in the hospital or blah, blah, blah. And OSHA is going to be on your doorstep. So how do we prepare for this? Well, first thing, and this is OSHA required, OSHA guideline 1348 is the guideline for the prevention of workplace violence in healthcare, and social service workers. It very clearly says you need to develop a written workplace violence prevention program. Friends, every one of your practices needs to develop this. You need to have a written workplace violence prevention program. Now, OSHA uses the term zero tolerance. I don't buy into that. We don't have the ability to say zero tolerance. We can say it with our employees. Yeah, if you become unprofessional, violent, threatening, whatever, with a patient or a family member, you're terminated. Yeah, zero tolerance with our employees, absolutely. But zero tolerance in the workplace doesn't work because we can't control the behavior of that patient. We can't control the behavior of that family member. So in some cases, we are the vulnerable victim. So when we talk about developing a written program, please don't get obsessed with the terms zero tolerance. It's not a realistic term. We need to train our employees to recognize escalating behavior before violence erupts. And, you know, we've had the privilege, we've trained, by now tens of thousands of workers across the country, healthcare workers in the last 10 or 15 years, in recognizing and de-escalating aggressive behavior before violence erupts. And one of the things you have to realize, people don't typically go from a state of calm to a state of physically violent in the blink of an eye. They go through a number of behavioral changes that lead up to that physical violence. Unfortunately, most healthcare workers are not trained to recognize those changes in behaviors. Ergo, they don't recognize it's happening until the aggressor is physically assaulting them, or as we jokingly say in the class, growing lumps on their head. But if we train our employees to recognize the different levels of aggression before it becomes physically violent, we do a much better job then at helping them to de-escalate. We call it the aggression continuum. It's the six levels of it's the six levels of behavioral changes that a person goes through between calm and physically violent. Now, we use the visual aid of a 6-foot stepladder when we train this. It's easy to appreciate stepladder, and we see them around the homes, we see them around the offices, we see them in the hospitals. You know, everybody's got one, 6-foot stepladder. Each rung on that ladder represents a change in behavior. If you're looking at the ladder, look at the bottom rung. Think about you as the individual standing on that bottom rung. You've got the length or the height of that ladder to help you maintain your balance. You've got those green side rails in our illustration to hold on to. You've got the ladder itself that you can lean into. There's all kind of ways to keep yourself safe when you're on that bottom rung. In the aggression continuum, we call that bottom rung calm. That's where most of us are. We hope, and that's where most of the people that you deal with are. Every step of the ladder that we go up represents a change in behavior that's closer to physical violence. Now, when you get up close to that top rung, think about yourself standing on that fourth or fifth rung. Suddenly you don't have those side rails to hold on to. Suddenly you don't have the length of that ladder to lean into to help brace yourself. The higher up you go on the ladder, the more precarious it becomes, until ultimately you get to that top rung up there, that top step, where there's that big sticker up there that says, hey, dummy, don't stand here. You're going to fall and get hurt. That's where the physical violence is. But, you know, most people, and I'm putting emphasis on the word most because there are exceptions, most people don't go from the bottom rung to the top rung in the blink of an eye. They go through these behavioral changes, becoming verbally agitated, verbally hostile, verbally threatening, physically threatening before they become physically violent. Unfortunately, most healthcare workers are not trained to recognize this. They only recognize physical violence. So my encouragement to you, my words of encouragement to you, is that you will please train your employees in the different steps in the continuum and help them not only to recognize the behavioral changes with each of these different levels of behavior, but how to recognize the different levels and how to de-escalate that person back down to a state of calm at each of these levels. The next topic, you know, that we're seeing more and more of, and one of the areas I said earlier, we're not lucky, we're blessed. One of the areas where I'm blessed is I've got a couple of former police officers that work for me, and they've got some really good contacts still, even though they're not out on the streets per se anymore. But one of the things we're seeing with the COVID isolation is two things, actually. Number one, we're seeing a big spike in domestic violence calls, as I said in the introduction, and we're seeing a decrease in the number of calls to Department of Children and Family Services here in Illinois on the number of sex abuse cases. If you think about it, that's understandable because the number one reporters of sexual abuse in children are school teachers. It's a mandatory report in Illinois. When they see anything, valid or not, if it's suspected, they have to report it, as do you as physicians in physician practices. But we're seeing a tremendous decrease in the report of abuse of children to DCFS, but police agencies are seeing a spike in domestic violence. Domestic violence, as the screen says, any pattern of abusive behavior in any relationship that is used by one partner to gain or maintain control over another intimate partner. And it lists a number of different types of abuse: physical, sexual, emotional, economic, psychological, threats, stalking, cyber stalking, all of these different ways that the abusive partner domestically violates the other partner. So, you know, we have to be sensitive to that, not only as caregivers, but, you know, the commonality we all deal with, friends, is that, and I'm an employer also, you know, as I said, we've got 18 employees. Every one of my employees, every one of your employees have things going on in their lives that you know nothing about or that you know only as much about as they want you to know. Let's face it, you and I both have employees having extramarital affairs. We have employees who are having financial difficulties. We have employees who have physically abusive spouses. We have employees who have spouses with alcohol abuse, drug abuse. We have employees who have problematic kids. We have employees who have problematic adult kids who are abusive of their parents. And we only know about as much of this in the workplace as they want us to know. My concern is, you know, yeah, we like to say what goes on inside a person's home is their own business, but that's not true. Because if a person is the victim of domestic violence in the home, there is a documented risk of the domestic violence finding its way into the workplace. In this case, it could be your office or your practice. Right? I'll be showing you some examples here in a few minutes of some different cases. And I will mention this again, the number of cases where domestic violence started in the home and finds its way into the workplace. You know, we all want to believe when we get to work, it's a haven of safety and security. And my friends, that's not true anymore. I'm sorry to burst the bubble, but our employees are as vulnerable in the workplace as they are in their homes. Unfortunately, that vulnerability expands in the workplace because it also makes the rest of us, your staff, you, your patients, your visitors in the waiting room, it makes all of them vulnerable because you don't know what the behavior of the abusive partner is going to be when he or she comes in. You know, here's a perfect example, and this was a case I was involved with and familiar with the case on an intimate level. This individual, the young lady who was the victim in this case, worked in a nursing home in Ohio. her ex-husband was quite threatening, quite abusive, and had an order of protection against him. He violated the order of protection and was arrested and put in jail by a local police agency. Mommy and daddy couldn't stand the thought of their precious little boy being locked up in jail, so they bailed him out. And what did he do as soon as they bailed him out? Thanks, Mom. Thanks, Dad. I promise I'll leave her alone. Yeah, right. Got a handgun, drove to the nursing home where she worked, sat out in the parking lot waiting for her to get off work. When she came walking out after getting off work at 7 a.m. giving report, she left about 7:30, didn't realize he was out in the parking lot. He walked up to her in the parking lot and shot her several times and killed her right there in the parking lot. Right? This is what I mean when I say domestic violence can start in the home but find its way into the workplace. This is but one isolated example. My friends, if we had all night, I could give you probably 20 cases that I've been involved with where we have a domestic violence situation in a healthcare facility, and I can give you hospitals, I can give you long-term care, I can give you physicians' practices, I can give you MSURG centers, I can give them to all to you where these events have taken place. The fact is that domestic violence finds its way into the workplace and turns everybody into a victim. So how do we prepare? Well, there's a few things we can do to help prepare for domestic violence. The first one is to lay a foundation. And what I mean when I say that is you have to decide, should I, as the practice owner, practice manager, take the initiative to put together a program and put it in front of our employees, or should I wait for our employees, for somebody to be a victim, and then say, okay, we're going to put a program together? I would encourage you to be proactive. I'm a risk manager with a lot of years now, right? There's a number of different ways we manage risk. The most effective and valued way is what we call risk avoidance, right? Or we avoid the risky activity altogether. We can't do that in healthcare. The second most valued technique is what we call risk control techniques. And that's what we want to do here. We want to put together programs proactively before an event ever occurs. And that's what I mean by lay a foundation. We want to put together this program where we can be proactive and have a good domestic violence prevention program. And you remember a few minutes ago when I talked about workplace violence, I talked about having a written workplace violence prevention program. You can either have a separate domestic violence program, or you can have a domestic violence program that is incorporated into your written workplace violence prevention program. But I would encourage you, lay that foundation, be proactive. You know, this is a great team sport. Especially, and you know, we don't want to ask them, we're probably never going to get people to admit in the workplace, oh yeah, I'm the victim of domestic violence. But if you're looking for team members, and I'm a big advocate of team building for a program like this, there's much more success in using a team of staff members than there is trying to do it by yourself. Develop that team. You may be surprised the number of people that want to be a part of it. And without saying so, they may be telling you it's based on their own experiences. Create a domestic violence policy. Now, the policy we really want is one that's going to encourage our employees to report domestic violence confidentially so that we can take steps that will not only protect them, but will protect the rest of our staff, will protect our patients, and will protect our visitors when they're sitting in the waiting rooms. So, you know, that policy is a critical part. Now, in Illinois, we can't force them to. I will tell you that we were doing a vulnerability assessment at a hospital in the state of Virginia a couple of years ago. And we were looking at their HR manual to see how it addressed security issues, specifically workplace violence and domestic violence. And they have it as a condition of employment that if you are the victim of domestic violence in the home, you have to report it to the employer confidentially to the HR department. And they will take appropriate steps to protect you and everyone else. If you fail to protect, or excuse me, if you fail to report, it's grounds for termination. Now, I'm not an attorney, nor do I try to play one, but I have my doubts if that were challenged, if it would hold up in court. But I commend the hospital for what they're trying to do. They realize the criticality of this domestic violence situation. This is in a pre-COVID world, so I can only imagine now. They realize the criticality of this domestic violence situation, and they're doing whatever they can to get their employees to report so they can take the appropriate steps to protect everybody. We also want to train our staff. So there's three things that we want to train our staff in: recognizing domestic violence, reporting domestic violence, and referring victims to the appropriate agencies to get them help. We call it the three R's: recognize, report, and refer. Once we develop our program, then we want to campaign the program. All right, we want to market it to our employees. We want them to understand this is something we're doing for them, not to them. And we want them to understand that our only goal is their safety and the safety of everybody else that may be in the practice at any given moment in time. And we want to publicize the program. Let's let it be known. Make it aware to the hospitals that you have privileges at. Let it be known to your insurance company. My gosh, yes. You know, these are people you want to let this program be known to for a couple of different reasons. Number one, they're looking for model programs. And number two, they will recognize you for your efforts to minimize the risk. It may be, there may be some financial benefits there as well. You got to realize, guys, it takes time. And I've been involved in so many domestic violence incidents with my healthcare clients. I'll tell you straight up, you know, look you in the eye if I could. Domestic violence victims don't want to be honest about it. They don't want to tell you. And you've seen that with your own patients. But I'm not only talking patients, I'm talking employees. They don't want anybody to know what's going on in their home. They don't want anybody on the outside to ever think that there could be something wrong on the inside. We have to give it time. It's not an overnight task, even though it's an important one. Right? It's going to take a while to make an impact in your practice and to make it safer for everyone. But it starts with tomorrow. It starts with following those steps that I just laid out and start putting a program together. Make sure your employees know. And again, as I said, OSHA requires a written workplace violence prevention program. And I would advise you to incorporate domestic violence as well, because we've identified the risk. Now let's talk about active shooter, because this is one, you know, if COVID's done anything, it's put active shooter events in on the back burner, but we're starting to see them again. I just, as recently as today, there was an event somewhere out on the East Coast. I don't remember exactly where, but it's irrelevant, where an individual went into a hospital and shot up a couple of people, a couple of caregivers. So, you know, these are still happening. They're just not getting the media attention right now, but, you know, it is something that concerns me. I've had client facilities of mine, mostly long-term care, where family members haven't been able to come in and visit mom or grandma for an extended period of time now, and they've been pushed to the breaking point. And I've actually had some of my facilities that have had family members threaten them to bring a gun in and force a way in and shoot the place up if they have to, just to get to visit mom. So, you know, there's no such thing as an idle threat. Now, we define an active shooter as a person or persons whose activity is immediately causing death or serious vital injury. It's not contained, and there is a risk of death or serious injury to everybody in the facility. Now, please understand, it's not a security event. It's not an elopement. It's not a person with a weapon. It's not a hostage event. This is a real life or death emergency. You know, I mentioned earlier, we got to start believing it can happen to us. I'm going to play a real quick video clip here, friends. This individual is a very dear friend of mine. I met him a number of years ago now at a conference that I was actually doing an active shooter training program for. And he was the speaker right after me. And we became very good friends. He stayed in my home a couple times when he's here in the Chicago area. I've done programs all over the nation with him now. During this COVID confinement, we actually do, I'll be very honest, we do virtual happy hour together every other Friday at 4 p.m. Central Time, where we all get on Zoom, a few of us in the network, and just have a couple of cocktails and just settle down and enjoy each other's friendship and camaraderie. So without saying his name, you're going to recognize his story and probably his name as well.
My name is Frank DeAngelis, and I was at Columbine High School for 35 years. I spent the last 18 years of my career as principal of the high school. And if you would have asked me April 20th, 1999, could a Columbine have happened at Columbine, I would have said, no way. It was a school in which we had our kids graduate, 95% of our kids graduate on time, over 85% of our kids went on to college, a lot of parental support. It was a school that was known for its excellence. and then April 20th, 1999 happened, a day in which my life changed forever, along with all the people that were part of the Columbine School community. And I'm amazed when I go out to these other communities that experience similar tragedies, such as Chardon in Ohio or Virginia Tech or Sandy Hook. They're in a state of denial, also feeling that it does not happen. And my message to you is it could happen to anyone on any given day. And I think it is so important that you're prepared. And just by not talking about it does not mean it's not going to happen. And many of the lessons learned from Columbine are being implemented today that are saving lives. So once again, don't underestimate the power of tragedy striking your community. I think it's so important to be prepared, because once again, on any given day, you can come into your community.
You know, as I said, Frank and I are very dear friends. We shot that a couple of years ago. I had him here in town doing a conference with me for our community, and just called up a buddy of mine who's in the video production business. He came over to the local Hilton Conference Center, set up the camera, and we shot that. And that was just Frank talking from the heart. There was no script or anything else. How easy would it be, guys? Let me ask you this. I'm going to say, guys, I apologize. I'm certainly not being gender specific. Let me ask you this, folks. How easy would it be for me, if I were a bad guy, to walk into your office tomorrow with a handgun and just come walking in and just wreak havoc? How easy would it be for me to come in off the hallway door? How easy would it be for me to come up to the receptionist window? How easy would it be to get past that door that separates the treatment area from the waiting room? And like I said, don't fool yourself that it hasn't happened before. One that's on the screen right now, June of 2017. Patient tried to make an appointment at a Vegas medical office, couldn't get in, got frustrated, went out to his car, got a gun, shot two employees before he turned the gun on himself. They just simply told him they couldn't fit him in because they were that busy. So he goes out to a gun, or his car, gets a gun, comes back in and shoots two employees and kills them before he turns the gun on himself. Kentucky, 2017. Manhunt in Trimble County led to the arrest of a man wanting connection of a shooting at the doc's office. 38-year-old victim had filed, here we go, domestic violence order of protection against Timothy Riddle the day before she was shot and killed. Said the offender walked into the clinic where the victim worked, shot her, and fled. How easy would that be in your practice? Another one, Pierce County, Washington. Owner of the clinic and the husband of a massage therapist who works in the clinic found dead inside. And they had a little bit of a, what do you want to call it, their relationship going on. And apparently the husband of the woman found out and dropped into the office after hours, caught her and the other gentleman together, and took actions into his own hands and put an end to it. This one's local, Mishawaka, Indiana, July of 2017. Indiana man shot and killed himself shortly after gunning down a doctor who refused to prescribe an opioid medication to his wife. Said the shooter and his wife showed up at the doctor's office for an appointment on Wednesday morning. This guy becomes upset after the doctor told him he doesn't believe chronic pain requires opioids. Couple left, the husband with a gun returns a couple hours later, confronts the doctor, and guns him down. And guys, this is happening. We may or may not be aware of it, but this is happening on a frequent basis. And, you know, I've got news alerts and ticklers and everything else that alert me whenever it happens. And it's ongoing. COVID has not put an end to this. COVID is just stealing the headlines. So as I said a minute ago, think about it. How would you react? How easy would it be? And how would you react if it was happening in your office or your clinic? You know, we think we know how we're going to react when there's an event. We think we know how we're going to react in an emergency. Please forget that. It's not what you think. All right, we think we're going to do really well in an emergency, but the reality is most people don't perform well in an emergency. And again, in my intro, I mentioned 35 years in the fire service. You know, I've got a strong public safety background. I've seen just about every type of emergency you can imagine, and I've seen how people react. We know, though, studies have shown that people fail to respond in an emergency for a number of different reasons. First one is they have a subconscious need for normalcy. You know, every one of us, I'm an employer, you're an employer, every one of us have a commonality. We've all got these employees who are our superstars, and we've all got employees who are our I like a better term, as I say in our life programs, I call them our dogs. They're good people, but they're not great workers. Our best day at work is the day they call off sick. And I say that with no disrespect. I've got them. I appreciate it. I understand it. We expect a lot out of our superstars. They're great in what they do, as long as a state of normal is being maintained. But we expect them to be superstars in a crisis too. And that doesn't always happen, because they are the people that have the need for normalcy. They're the best of the best under day-to-day operations. But when everything's breaking loose, they're not going to be the superstars you think they are. Some people have an overwhelming sense of denial. I mean, that's not a river in Egypt, right? They can't fathom that this is happening. They can't fathom that somebody, whether it's workplace violence, domestic violence, a shooter, whatever, they just want to be in a state of denial. No, this isn't happening. No, this will pass, right? They're unable to comprehend the scope of the event, right? And they have this optimistic bias that just relax, it'll go away, it'll fix itself, it'll be okay. You know, there's a commonality there. All four of those are individual traits. They're on the individual who finds himself in that position. But there's four more that fall on us as the employer in reasons that people fail to respond to emergencies. Number one, we do a lousy job creating a safety culture in the workplace. We do a great job creating a clinical culture. We do a great job creating a culture of caring, of support, of being there for our patients and their families. But we do a lousy job sometimes of creating a culture of safety for our staff. We talk about it. We give it lip service. Excuse me. It's been a long day, and I'm still speaking at 7:30 at night. This is the third one of these I've done today. So, you know, lack of a safety culture is on us, guys. No planning, no preparedness. We think it can't happen to us, so we've never done anything in planning or preparing. And all of a sudden, when it does happen, nobody knows what to do. Shame on us. Poor training. I see so many of my clients, and I'll ask them, tell me about your emergency preparedness training. I don't care if it's workplace violence, active shooter, fire emergency, loss of utilities, and I get the same ridiculous response. Oh, gosh, Steve, we've got an excellent program. We have our employees once a year. They have to watch 5 videos on emergency preparedness on different situations and be ready to respond. Friends, with all due respect, that sets off my yippee-skippy detector. Right? You cannot train people just by having them watch a video. As much as I despise, well, let me rephrase it. As much as I'm not a fan of the Joint Commission, they require competency-based training, and I am a cheerleader of theirs in that regard. You can't ask somebody to watch a video and expect them to be able to perform. And, you know, we use the terms educate and training interchangeably, but they mean two very different things. Please remember, we educate the mind, we train the hands. And if we are just watching videos, we're doing a great job educating the mind, but the hands don't know what to do. And all the knowledge in the world is useless if we haven't trained their hands on how to perform. So we have to make sure we do competency-based training in these things. And again, we need to do exercises. We need to do drills. It's no different than anything else in your emergency operation plan. We need to be prepared. The risk is there. We have to be prepared. There's 5 steps to putting together a good active shooter program, or friends, for this matter, any of the programs we talked about, domestic violence, workplace violence, active shooter, right? The first one is conduct a security vulnerability assessment. We'll talk about that momentarily. Right? Next, after we've done the SVA, the security vulnerability assessment, develop an active shooter emergency response plan. Develop your workplace violence prevention plan. Develop your domestic violence response plan, prevention plan. Then develop a correlating training program with it. Then train your staff on your plan. And at the end of the day, plan for recovery. Right, let's look at those. First of all, conduct that security vulnerability assessment, or an SVA. Security vulnerability assessment is a formal process, for those not familiar with it. It's a formal process that looks at your security management program. And I'm not talking about uniform guards or any of that nonsense. What I'm talking about is security management as a managerial process. And it answers several questions. Number one, from what and from whom should we be protecting ourselves? In other words, what are the threats that are out there? Well, we've mentioned a lot of threats today. We've mentioned frustrated family members. We've mentioned stressed out workers. We've mentioned armed intruders. We've mentioned domestic violence. We've mentioned workplace. You know, these are all threats. These are all things that can cause us a problem in the practice that we have to be prepared to protect ourselves from. Helps us to identify what are the chinks in the armor in our security management program that could allow these events to occur in our practice. And when I talk about the chinks in the armor, I'm talking about those events. You know, I mentioned it earlier, how easy is it for me to walk from the waiting room back to the treatment area? How easy is it for me to reach through that open window at the reception desk and grab that receptionist? Those are chinks in the armor in our security program that could lead to an event taking place. And if one of these events does occur, what are the risks or what are the likely consequences or potential outcomes? And in this case, when I use the term risks, I'm talking about potential outcomes. If I smoke cigarettes, I risk lung cancer. If I don't wear a seatbelt, I risk serious injury if I get in an accident. So in this case, the risks are the potential outcomes or consequences. So if one of those events occur, what are the potential consequences that we have to deal with? Loss of our reputation, loss of a staff member, loss of a patient, loss of multiple patients, loss of multiple people, loss of our good standing in the community, loss of our privileges at the hospital. There's all kinds of consequences that could be recognized. And then once we know the answers to those three questions, now we can look at, okay, what can I do to minimize our vulnerability? Again, go back to what I said earlier about managing risk. We want to use exposure avoidance whenever possible, but that's not practical here. So I want to look at risk control techniques. What can I do to minimize? What risk control techniques can I use to minimize the vulnerability or the threat of something happening? Once I do that, I develop my, in this case, active shooter plan. But again, it could be my workplace violence plan. It could be my domestic violence plan, whatever. I need to develop a plan. It needs to be realistic to the threat. Now, our workplace violence program for healthcare is very unique, and it's nationally acclaimed. I'm very proud of it. It's been adopted as a program of choice by Argentum, which is formerly the Assisted Living Federation of America. They recommend to their 30,000 members across the United States, they use our program. It's been recognized by the Joint Commission. We're very proud of the program, but we teach some things that other programs don't. First of all, the shooter may be looking for one specific person. Let's talk about domestic violence real quick. I come in, I'm looking for my ex-wife. She's trying to get more alimony out of me. She's trying to get more child support out of me, blah, blah, blah. She wants a house, the car, whatever the case may be. I come in looking just specifically for her. I have violence on my mind. I'm going to be violent against her, in this case, in the form of use of a firearm. But I'm no threat to anybody else there. I'm after her and her only. Or I may be so mad I'm going to shoot up everybody in the practice. Anybody and everybody who's in that office at the time I come in. I don't care if you're at the reception desk. I don't care if you're a visitor in the waiting room or a patient in the waiting room waiting to be seen. I don't care if you're in the back and you're in an exam room. I don't care if you're sitting at the nurse's station in the back or the physician station in the back. I'm just going to shoot everybody and anybody. I'm so angry. You know, there's different types of events that take place. You know, this is one that we train all of our clients. There's not going to be any code team responding. If you don't know how to respond to save yourself, you're probably in a lot of trouble. And that's why I say this training is so critical. This is not watch a video stuff. It may be only you and a colleague to get through this alive. And we're going to look at some ways, again, that if you're in the office and you have an intruder come in, whether they're a shooter or, you know, somebody who is screaming and creating a ruckus and, you know, they're going to beat the you-know-what out of their spouse or whatever the case may be, these techniques that we're going to talk about next are going to help you. You have to accept the fact chaos will reign. I don't care how much we do train, and I'm a proponent of training. You probably got that by now. But I don't care how much you do train. You know, nobody expects this to really happen. And when it really happens, chaos is going to reign. We need to develop our plan with both our employees and our patients in mind. We can't forget our employees. Number one, OSHA says your active shooter plan has to address your employees. OSHA says your workplace violence prevention program has to address employees. OSHA says your domestic violence plan has to address employees. It can't be just about patients and visitors. If there's an intruder, we need to train our employees to either escape, hide, fight, but most of all, survive. And that's what the focus is always going to be on, is survival. Right? Denying that it can happen. Guys, I'm pounding this home because I'm so committed to this statement. Denying it can happen has no survival value. Talked about it at the beginning. I showed you a lot of different events that have occurred. You heard Frank DeAngelis talk about not thinking it could ever happen to Columbine. You know, denial has no survival value. Right? You know, we want to develop our plan with survival mindset. We want your written plan to address exits out of the practice. How can I get out? If I get out, where do I go? OSHA says you have to have a reunification point. Where am I going to go? Where are our employees trained to go? So that we can do that accountability check that's required of us. What about hiding places in the practice? I can't get out the door. What about hiding places? What about barriers, locks on the doors, ways that I can barricade the doors that don't lock, weapons of opportunity in case I have to protect and defend myself? You know, our offices are surrounded by weapons of opportunity. We never recognize it because we don't think about them as weapons. You know, how about that otoscope that's on the wall with that long cord attached to it? If push came to shove, that becomes a very nice choking tool. What about that stethoscope that's around your neck? That becomes a choking tool. What about that pen that's in the pocket of your lab coat? That becomes an edged weapon if it needs to be. You know, if we have to protect ourselves in a life or death situation, we have to know what we've got to be able to use as a weapon of opportunity. Your training strategy is provide a range of options. I don't want a program that says, you know, again, I don't care if we're talking active shooter, armed intruder, if we're talking angry spouse that shows up, domestic violence, workplace violence, angry family, whatever. We don't want a program that says, if this happens, do this. No, that doesn't work. It's too many variables. We need a program that says develop a range of options and choices for our people to follow. We want to give them options. We want to give them choices for survival. Again, I've said it many times, survival is not a random outcome. It's a result of training and preparedness. And your program should have four steps when we talk about training. Awareness, which is basically what we're doing tonight. Preparedness, develop written plans that address all the things we've talked about tonight. And start preparing your employees for the risk. The likelihood of it happening, albeit true, very small, very remote, but it can still happen. Drills and exercises. We need to practice this. We need to perfect our skills. We need to perfect our plans. And the last one, evaluations and improvements. This is a continuous quality improvement operation, guys. All right, we need to evaluate every exercise, every drill we do. This evaluation is not about patting ourselves on the back. This evaluation is about saying, okay, where did we do well, but where can we do better? You know, people get scared of the training because they think, oh, that's going to make people think it can happen. You know, and that's on top of my nonsense detector. You know, and I travel pre-COVID. I travel all over the country. I'm usually on at least, you know, 3 trips a month. Every one of those trips, I have to listen to a flight attendant, make me aware of where the emergency exit is, make me aware of how to use my seatbelt, make me aware of how to use my face mask if it drops down from the overhead compartment, blah, blah, blah. They don't do that to make us afraid to fly. They do that to help prepare us in the event of an emergency. We're not doing this training to scare our employees and make them think it's dangerous at work. We're doing this for the same reason the flight attendants do it, to help prepare us in case of an event. And that's the approach we want to take with our staff. We have no reason to believe it's going to happen here, but it still could. You know, it could be a robbery at the jewelry store across the street or the gas station, whatever. And somebody just comes running in off the street seeking a hiding place. And all of a sudden, all of us are in harm's way. So, you know, there's nothing to guarantee it won't happen. There's certainly no reason to believe it will, though. We developed a program for healthcare a number of years ago. And this is a program I still are very proud of. It's being used on a national level. It's called the Four Outs. Now, you may have heard of a program in the past called Run, Hide, Fight. A lot of places try to use Run, Hide, Fight. Run, Hide, Fight is an excellent program. I use Run, Hide, Fight with my industrial clients. I use it with my retail clients. I do not use it with my healthcare clients. I do not use it with our educational clients. Your program has to recognize, you know, Run, Hide, Fight is great if all I have to worry about is myself. I'm in the shopping mall. I hear gunshots. All I got to worry about is myself. I'm in a restaurant. I hear gunshots. All I got to worry about is myself, right? And in the healthcare facilities and the healthcare setting, it's different, though. You've got patients in your practice who can't take care of themselves because of medical conditions, because of age. You know, there's a lot of different reasons. So Run, Hide, Fight doesn't work when we have to not only think about ourselves, but we also have to think about people who can't take care of themselves. We become their source of survival. We become their chance of survival. That's why we developed the 4 outs. And I mean, I'd like to tell you what geniuses we are, but the reality is this is Run, Hide, Fight on steroids. Right? We want you to write your plan based on the 4 outs. We want you to train for the 4 outs. Number one is get out. If you have an intruder in the building and we can get people out, get them out. Staff members, family members, patients, yourselves, physicians, nursing staff, whatever. You know, bad guys will not typically chase you out of the building. That's where the police are going to be. They don't want to go out there where the police are going to be. They feel safer inside the building. If you can't get out, hide out. That's why I said earlier, look at places inside where you can hide yourselves, barricade yourselves, and not be seen or recognized. Now, a lot of rooms in healthcare facilities, including practices, don't always have locks on the doors. So we need to think about, how am I going to barricade that door? If I'm in an exam room, doesn't have a lock on the door, how am I going to barricade that door so the perpetrator can't get in? Well, you've got exam tables, you've got furniture, you got everything else. Barricade the door, build that into your plan. And lastly, if the intruder, regardless of his intent, gets to you, how do you protect yourself? And friends, I've got to stress this. When you're dealing with a shooter, there is no such thing as talking them down. You know, when I talked about workplace violence, I talked about the continuum. I talked about, you know, the changes in behavior on the ladder. That does not apply here. There is no verbally de-escalating an armed intruder. They are there for one reason, and that is to kill. And when they come in the room, if you think that you or a social worker or anybody else can verbally de-escalate them, you're mistaken. There have been too many studies, and more critically, there have been too many fatalities by people trying to do that. When they come in, if they've got you trapped in the room, you have to prepare for the fight of your life. And I hate to sound that way, but the reality is, they're not coming in there to scare you. They're coming in there to kill you. And you've got to stop them. I'm not saying you have to kill them. I'm saying you have to stop them. All right, we'll talk more about these in a few minutes. Now, your training program I've already talked about, but I do want to drive home. It's got to be multi-level. That is a gentleman's way of saying, docs, you need to be in on the training. Don't, you know, and I promise you, if you ever have an event or if any of your employees ever call the OSHA 800 hotline, and OSHA walks through the door, the first thing they're going to want to see is your training records. And they're going to look to see that, yeah, you, doctor, practice owner, practice manager, you, madam or Mr. Operations manager or whatever your title might be, they want to see that the senior management is participating in the training. They do not want an environment where the hourly staff is going through the training and senior leadership is not. And again, from a clinician's point of view, that includes you. I don't care if you're the practice manager. I don't care if you're one of the owners of the practice. You have to be in on this training. Because if a bad guy comes in, your staff are going to be looking to you for leadership. And if you didn't go through the training and you're telling them to do one thing and the training told them to do something else, who do they listen to? You know, this is a guaranteed penalty from OSHA, and it will be a six-figure penalty, I promise you. As I said, we want to train with choices and options. I've already beaten that up. I don't need to say it again. Right. Now, realize that there's a couple of commonalities and a lot of dissimilarities between trained and untrained people. The biggest commonality, though, is startle and fear. I don't care how many training programs I've been through. I don't care how many training programs I've taught. If we have an armed intruder, there's going to be startle and fear. You know, I spent 35 years in the fire service. I've run into a lot of burning buildings. I always joke and say I ran into the buildings that the rats and the cockroaches were running out of. right? I don't care how well trained I was, and I prided myself on being well trained. I taught at the State Fire Academy for 25 years. I consider myself a very advanced trained firefighter. I don't care how much training I had, though. I always had fear going into that building. And you need that fear to maintain your composure. That fear helps you to be a better thinker. I knew what fire was going to do. I've seen almost every form of fire known to man except nuclear, right? I knew what that fire was going to do, but I didn't know what that building was going to do. So I didn't have all the answers. So I was vulnerable. Same thing here. We may know a lot about intruders and shooters and all that, but we don't know what their intent is. We don't know what direction they're going. We don't know who they're going for or if they're just going for everybody. So startle and fear will be a common response. But there's a lot of uncommonalities too. When you look at people who go through and are trained and prepared in this stuff, they're going to have anxiety. Yeah, none of us signed up for this. They're going to recall, though, what they've learned in the training programs you provided or brought in for them or whatever the case may be. Past recollection recalled, right? They went through a training program. They may not remember. They may not remember who taught it or anything else. But when the rubber meets the road, that training comes back into the forefront of their memories. And they're going to react as they've been trained to do. And I've seen it happen a lot of times. But people who don't go through training, and again, no disrespect, but I do include physicians, I do include nursing management, I do include practice managers in this. If you don't participate in the training, you are part of the problem. Right? It's not going to be anxiety. It's going to be panic. You didn't go through the training, so you have nothing to recall. So you're going to be frozen with fear, disbelief, and denial. You can practice in your own mind all you want what you're going to do and how you're going to be the hero. But I promise you, from years of experience now, that when it happens, you're going to freeze. You're going to be shocked. You're going to deny it's happening. And you're going to stay frozen in shock and denial. You are going to be a liability to your group and not an asset to your group. Now, the one thing, you know, none of us ever want to believe that we could have a shooter in the building. The one thing I tell everybody, trust your gut. You know, I've talked to a lot of facilities. I've worked with a lot of medical facilities that have had shooters. The one thing I see and hear all the time is, I couldn't believe we had a shooter in the building. And what did you think it was? Well, I thought a car had backfired. Well, when was the last time you heard a car in your waiting room? You know, people look for things. They want it to be something else. I thought somebody was setting off firecrackers. I'm sorry. When was the last time somebody set off firecrackers in your office? I thought somebody slammed a phone book on the desk. Hell, we don't even have phone books anymore. We Google. Right? Trust your gut, guys. If it sounds like gunfire, believe it is until it's proven otherwise, right? And react accordingly. You know, I mentioned earlier the four outs, and here we are right there. Get out, hide out, keep out, and take out. When I say get out, we want to run. We want to move quickly. We want to leave our belongings behind. We don't want to wait for others to agree. You know, if I've got a coworker, no, I'm scared, I'm going to hide in here. Okay, good luck to you. I'm getting out. Right, you can't force them to go. They're adults. They've got the right to make their own decisions. But you can't lose your life because they decided to stay. And you want to use the nearest exit away from the suspect. Now, one of the first things anytime we train, if you think there's shots fired, first thing I want you to do is try to make a conscious note, where are the shots in relationship to where I'm at in the building? If they're on a different floor, I've got time to get out. If they're sound like they're out in the hallway outside the office, I'm not going to go running out in that hallway. If we're going to try to get out, we always want to use a back exit if we can. Wherever the bad guy is at, we want to use a distal exit from his location. And, you know, most bad guys are really bad shots. That's the reality of it. Hollywood makes them out to be great shots, but they're terrible shots. Most people are terrible shots with aim. They're not trained with them properly. Every step you put between you and the bad guy is a lesser chance of you being shot. You know, any of us, myself included, and I have a concealed carry permit here in Illinois, and I have an indoor target range about a mile from my office, and I like to go there at lunch sometimes. There's a big difference between my capabilities hitting the target at 5 yards versus 7 yards versus 10 yards versus 15 yards versus 25 yards. The farther away the target, the less accurate my shot. And that's very true with the bad guys, too. Every step away from the bad guy you get, the less likely is the chances of you being shot. And one thing, train all your employees. And I'm a big proponent, let your employees carry their cell phones. and that is to call 911. Every one of your employees should be calling 911. And I've had people say, oh no, that's too many calls. I'm a former fire chief. I can tell you there's no such thing as too many calls to 911. Every call is going to give the dispatcher more and valuable information. So please encourage every employee, call 911. Now, as I said, I'm a big proponent of employees having their cell phones with them at work. I'm not a proponent of using their cell phones for nonsense. Our employees, every one of them is allowed to carry their cell phones when they're at work. But if we catch them on their phones playing Candy Crush or any of that nonsense, there's going to be some discussions going on. But I want every one of them to have their phone. So if we ever have an event of any kind, whether it's a shooter, domestic violence, whatever the case may be, and we've got 6 or 7 women that work there, and we have had 1 or 2 over the years who've been involved as victims of domestic violence, I want them to have the preparedness of being able to call for help. If you get a busy signal, that typically means that there's a lot of people calling. Good. Call back. Keep calling. And when you call 911, give them pertinent information. Do you know the name of the shooter? If you do, that's great information, because the negotiators, you know, if they can get a negotiation going, that's valuable when they know the name. Give them a description, and it can be a general description. White male, 6 foot tall, 260 pounds, wearing a black polo shirt, blue jeans, and gray tennis shoes. Okay. Where is he at in the building? You know your office suite numbers. Don't tell him he's in Dr. Taylor's office. Tell him he's on the 3rd floor in suite 320. Okay. And if you know the number and type of weapon, let the dispatcher know that as well, the police dispatcher. It doesn't matter if it's a Smith & Wesson, a Glock, a Kimber. I don't care if it's a 40 caliber, a 9mm, an AR-15. Police need to know 2 things. Is it a handgun or is it a long gun? A handgun is one you hold in your hand. A long gun is one that one butts up to your shoulder. And that's all they need to know. Now, if we can't get out, we go to plan B, hide out. Remember I said earlier, give your employees options. Build options into your plan. If you're going to hide out, that means we're going to stay in the building. We're going to stay in the suite maybe. And we're going to try to get into an inconspicuous place. We're going to turn off the lights. We're going to close the blinds. We want to be quiet. We don't want the bad guy to know we're there. We're going to spread out. We don't want to all be bunched up together. If we can't lock the doors, if we can lock the doors, do lock them. If we can't, we're going to barricade them with heavy objects. If the door has a window in it, put some kind of a cover. I don't care if you just scotch tape paper over it. Put a cover up so the bad guy can't look in the window and see if there's potential victims in there. And again, as I said earlier, you're trapped in a room now. You need to prepare a counterattack. Put together your survival plan. And again, call 911. Check and see, too, in a lot of communities now, as technology advances, they now have 911 texting. So you might be able to use that as well. Check in your local communities with your local carriers if that's available. Now, I mentioned in healthcare, oftentimes we're not allowed to have locks on the doors. Right? If we have locks on the doors, as I said a minute ago, use them. All right. Goal here to keep out those, keep the bad guy out. Use whatever equipment you can to block the door. Use your exam tables. Use your chairs. Stockpile stuff on top of the exam tables. Anything and everything you've got. You know, you got to realize, guys, from the time the first shot is fired and people call 911, the bad guy knows the police are responding. And he's going to be moving quickly. You know, in Hollywood, the bad guy will kick in the door. Or in Hollywood, the bad guy will shoot the lock off the door. That's Hollywood. That's not reality. It doesn't work that way. You know, most of your practices, if they're code complying with code, the doors are 1 3/4 inch solid core doors. He tries to kick that door in, probably the only thing he's going to do is a fib tib fracture. Right. So, you know, the reality is that what we see happening on Hollywood doesn't happen in real life. You know, they also make devices. You can go online. There's a ton of them out there now that you can slide under a door from the inside of the room so somebody from the outside cannot open the door. In the hospitals, in the nursing homes, the health department don't like these, but we're not talking about nursing homes and hospitals. We're talking about your practices. There's nothing that says you can't use something like this. Put them in the rooms, keep them in the cabinets, train your employees to use them. So if you're in an exam room or something and you have to isolate in there to protect yourself, you've got a device like this. And you can look at the screen right now and see they're relatively inexpensive and well worth it, small investment. And as I said a few minutes ago, if I have to protect myself as a last resort, I've got to prepare for combat. You know, there's no rules in this engagement. All right. You got to plan your attack. As I said earlier, talk about your weapons of opportunity. Commit to an action plan. You know, healthcare professionals have a hard time with this because we're so committed to being caregivers. We're so committed to do no harm to our patients. We have a hard time realizing that right now those rules go out the window and that if we don't do something, we're never going home to our loved ones again. Your children will grow up without a mom or a dad. Your spouse or your significant other will lose the most important person in their world. And this person is not coming in to scare you. They are coming in with bad intent, and you have to protect yourself. You have to commit to action. Do whatever it takes. Do it without hesitation. You know, I always tell people, distract them. Imagine for a minute if I threw something at your face. What's your first reaction? You're going to put your hands up there to block it. You're going to turn away. You're going to flinch. Boom. The minute you do that, that's when I have my moment of opportunity. The minute you distract, the minute you put your hands up, the minute you look away, you're not paying attention to me. That's when I'm going to, at that very moment, go into my attack mode. I'm going to protect myself. I'm going to disable you. And I've had people tell me over and over at different conferences we presented this stuff at, Steve, I don't think I could kill somebody. Friends, I'm not saying kill them. I'm saying stop them. I don't care if you've got a fire extinguisher in the room and you use that as an impact tool on their head. It may not kill them. You don't have to kill them. You knock them out. You stop them. Kick the gun away and start screaming for help. Open the door and start screaming for help. Shooters down. Shooters down. Bad guys down. Bad guys down. I need help. Right? If they start to come to or get up again or whatever, you strike them again. Again, I'm not saying kill them. That's not the intent here. And realize when the police do get there, as I said a minute ago, from the first shot or the first call, police are coming and they're coming running in droves. I promise you, you're going to get bombarded with police officers. Comply with the police officer's orders. Do whatever they tell you. Now realize, they don't know who's a good guy and who's a bad guy. The bad guy may be dressed in scrubs to try to blend in. Police don't know if he works in your practice or if he's a bad guy dressed in scrubs. So in their mind right now, everybody is suspect. So you want to keep your hands high and your fingers spread. Don't have anything in your hands that a police officer could confuse with a weapon. Hands up, fingers spread, and keep them that way. And I don't even care if you know the cop. You may be in a small town, as I am in my hometown, where you know half the cops. You don't know this version of them. They are in a different place mentally right now than you probably have ever seen them. Don't run up to them. Don't try to shout at them. Don't point at them. Don't try to hug them. Oh, Bob, I'm so glad you're here. We were so scared. No, just do what they tell you. I don't care if they tell you to go lay in a mud puddle. Go lay in a mud puddle. You can ask them afterwards why. But right now, do what they say. You know, one of the guys I mentioned, blessed to have a couple of retired police officers work for me. Jimmy Telford's one of them. Jimmy is retired from the Telford, Pennsylvania Police Department right outside of Philadelphia. And Jim said this in a conference we were doing together one time. And it just really struck me. If that panic-stricken person runs at an officer and attempts to grab hold, she or he is likely to get knocked on his or her butt or worse. That officer, you're running up scared and trying to grab them as a security blanket. They don't know if you're trying to grab their gun or what. So, you know, don't do it. Don't put yourself in that position. And, you know, the last element, gang, is we need a recovery plan. This is true. I don't care if it's a fire, if it's a utility failure, if it's an armed intruder, if it's a domestic violence, a weather emergency, it doesn't matter. Every one of our potential emergency situations requires a recovery plan. And Dilbert standing on the front porch hollering help is not a recovery plan. Now, remember, if this is a shooter, domestic violence, workplace violence, training, it's a crime scene. Don't touch anything until the police tell you they are done. But your recovery plan, you need to have written into your emergency operation plan, again, an OSHA requirement, you need to have a crisis management plan. Now, what I tell my clients is I want you to think of every potential situation or what we call a hazard vulnerability assessment. If it happened to you, what are the potential outside resources you're going to be? Well, we've been talking about violence. We've been talking about shooters. Let's imagine we had a shooting event. What are some of the outside resources you're going to need afterwards? You're going to need crisis counseling for yourself, for your staff, for your patients, for your visitors. You're going to need cleanup and restoration. You can't ask your employees to clean that up. You're going to need some type of help with the media. So you're going to need a public relations firm or something along those lines. You're going to maybe need some security, either armed or unarmed, to protect the practice location, the facility, the physical plant, especially when the police leave and all you got now is a bunch of gawkers trying to get in. You're probably going to need defense attorneys, defense counsel. You're probably going to need risk management assistance. Right, right there, just off the top of my head, I named 6 or 7 things you're going to need. If that happened right now, would you have those resources immediately available? Or do you have to sit down with the Yellow Pages and start flipping through looking for security companies or looking for cleanup companies? Right, calling Service Master at 9 o'clock at night and thinking that they're going to be thrilled to hear from you and always there for you. They don't have a clue who you are because you don't have a pre-existing relationship. You need to develop relationships and enter into either contractual or at minimum memorandums of agreement with these providers in all those different areas I just talked about so that when you need them, they're there for you. Right? I had an incident a couple of weeks ago with one of my clients here in Illinois. It was actually on the southwest side of Chicago in a very gang prevalent area where an individual came in and physically attacked and beat the sweet bejeebies out of the dietary director, and this is an assisted living facility, out of the dietary director, and it turns out that the individual, the bad guy in this case, was the husband of a woman that the dietary director just fired a few days earlier. And the husband was so irate that he fired his wife that he came in and, like I said, he beat the bejeebies out of this dietary director right in the main lobby. And we needed to get crisis counseling in. We needed to get security in there. We needed to get some media help in there because Chicago news media was calling. And, you know, fortunately for our clients, we have an 800 24-hour crisis hotline where we've got prearranged agreements with everybody. But, you know, if you're in a situation where you don't have those resources available to you, you need to sit down and get on the phone and start putting together some crisis management plans and some resource plans. Need to realize that recovery starts when the event is over. Don't try to start recovery during a dynamic event. And our goal is always to return to normal, whatever that may mean, or to at least a safer state of affairs as quickly as possible. And it may take days, it may take weeks, months, years. Columbine, using that as an example, was a crime scene for 9 months before they could even go in and start cleanup, before they could even go in and start restoration. You know, like I said earlier, it's not like we see on Hollywood. It's not like we see on YouTube. It took a long time of renovation to make that school occupiable again. But as it says before, the key is the evaluation of the potential events and to know the resources you're going to need and to put that recovery plan together before it occurs. So, you know, we've reached a point now. I know we went a little bit over, but Cindy said that, you know, with a topic like this, that going over may not necessarily be as bad as I might think. So, at this point, Cindy, I'm quite happy to take any questions we might have. I'm going to give the screen back to you, I'll be happy to entertain any questions.
Actually, Steve, if you could put it back up and just advance the slides, that would be great.
Okay.
In the meantime, all right. If you had any questions, please type them into the Q&A box. And we will get to them. I wanted to just go over a few of the resources that we have and tell you about, advance it once. There should be another one on there maybe? No?
Does not appear to be.
Oh, okay. All right, well then we will just go to our questions then. So the first question, are you able to provide a service to other states, let's say New Jersey?
Absolutely. We were just last April of 2019, we were with the New Jersey Osteopathic Physician Association and did some programs for them at Atlantic City at their annual conference. We go all over the nation. We've got clients in 49 states. I can't get into Montana, but Montana's the only state we haven't worked in.
Okay. And then Steve did have his contact information up there. So hopefully You got it. If not, the slides will have it as well. Can you place the, place your contact information slide up again, Steve. That's what everybody wants.
Okay, I will do that. Stand by.
All right. And then the next one while you're working on that is...
You should be seeing it now. Yep. Is it up there?
That it is. That's good.
All
is
right.
Having a gun owner armed at work a good idea?
In a word, no. And the reason I say that is a few different reasons. Number one, how's your insurance going to feel about that? Probably not real good. Number two, if you use that gun at work, are you using it as an agent of the practice, an employee of the practice, or using it as an individual? It's just, and you know, the other one is, how proficient are you with the gun? You know, as I said, I'm a concealed carry card holder myself. I carry a concealed weapon a lot of the time, not all the time, but a lot of the time. You know, after 35 years in the fire service, I could shoot the wings off a fly at 100 yards with a fire hose in my hands. But by my own admission, I'm still not that proficient with a handgun. And to use it in a closed area where somebody may be shooting back at me, which I'm not used to at all. I'm getting better at a piece of paper hanging from the ceiling, but that's a totally different world. If I miss and that bullet goes through the wall, you know, what happens if I hit somebody on the other side? You know, that happened at St. Anthony Hospital in Alton a number of years ago. I had an armed intruder come into, let me rephrase that. They had a mental health patient, female, came into the emergency room for treatment. They put her in an exam room. She had her purse. As was protocol, security came in, asked her to empty her purse. She had a handgun in there. Security says, we'll take it and hold on to it until you're discharged. She says, no, you won't. They get into a wrestling match over the handgun. It discharges. And honest to God, in this hospital is one of my clients. The nurse that we interviewed that was working at the ER desk said she heard the bullet go whistling by her ear. It came that close to striking her in the head. So no, I'm not a big fan of employees carrying firearms in the workplace at all. I do. My business partner does. He's a former police officer. The two police officers that I employ, they do. But that's in the workplace, never in the field.
Okay. Should we have mace or a taser in the office?
I don't have a problem. Well, first of all, anything you use like that, tasers are not good for civilian use. I don't have a problem with chemical weapons. Mace would be a bad choice because it will contaminate the entire environment. It's called oleoresin capsicum. We commonly know it as pepper spray. They make pepper spray in a couple different forms. They make it in a spray, in an aerosol spray, but they also make it in a foam concentrate. It is almost like shaving cream. My client hospitals that use it, I've got them using the spray when they're outside, for example, in the parking lot. But when they use it for inside use, they use the foam. And the reason for that being is because the spray will oftentimes, no, not oftentimes, every time, it will contaminate the room as badly as mace will. You will not be able to breathe. You might as well spray yourself in the face. The foam is not nearly as bad. You'll still get a little residual in the air, but nothing like you will with the spray. The foam, imagine I sprayed you in the face with shaving cream. What's the first thing you're going to do? You're going to wipe it off. When you wipe it off, when you wipe this foam off, it activates it. And now it's in the mucous membranes. You've activated it by rubbing it, and the world's a bad place for the bad guy. But the environment is still not as bad. If you're going to use anything like that, number one, make sure your local laws in your respective state permit it. And if you're going to use something like that in an indoor location, I would use the pepper foam.
Okay. All right. Thank you. And it looks like that is it on the questions. I thank you for the wealth of information. I'd be lying if I didn't say some of it is a little scary. But I think the world is scary at the moment, and it definitely is better to be prepared. So I definitely appreciate the information you shared with us. And I'm sure based on the comments that have come in, you may be hearing from some of our members. So we do appreciate it. Thank you all for joining us tonight. And again, thank you, Steve. Great job.
Thank you all, everybody. Stay safe. Call me if you have any questions.
All right. Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.